Welcome everyone to the first seminar of the fall 2022. And what a way to start welcoming our own Dr. Kaisa Taipale. Dr. Taipale is the director of data science at C.H. Robinson. She's one of the largest third-party logistics company in the United States. And before she joined C.H. Robinson, she was a faculty in the Department of School of Mathematics at the University of Minnesota. And her group does a lot of cool things. I will let her talk about that. Before she joined C.H. Robinson and before she was at the University of Minnesota, she also held a postdoctoral position at the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute, Cornell University, and St. Olaf College. Right. So without me taking any more time, let me welcome Dr. Taipale. Thank you very much for accepting my invitation.
All right, okay. So thank you for coming here. I'm very happy to be here with you. It's been a little while since I was here at the University of Minnesota, and certainly over the last few years, a lot has happened in our own lives, but also in logistics. So I've been at C.H. Robinson now for 3 years, and CHR is what one of my friends called the biggest company that you never heard of. Most people have not heard of C.H. Robinson, but as a third-party logistics company, we connect shippers with carriers, folks who have goods to move with folks who can move those goods. And as we all know, during COVID, the supply chain and logistics finally made the news. No longer is it a party stopper to say that you work in logistics. Instead, people are like, wow, that I heard about that on the news. We have a lot of services that we provide. This is sort of the corporate boilerplate slide, but it gives you an idea of the full range of services that C.H. Robinson provides, from global forwarding to local business. My group is very firmly in the North American truckload space. So we're really thinking about how to match shippers with goods to move in Canada, the US, and Mexico with truckers and trucking companies in Canada, the US, and Mexico. So let's see. Here's part of the structure. So you ask, what does C.H. Robinson do? Well, it does a lot of things. I, in particular, work in this North American truckload space, matching shippers who want to ship their soy sauce or toilet paper or electronics or lettuce across the country so that you can then use it, right? We don't charge fees or commissions on this business. That is not our business structure. What we instead do is we're, in essence, there are a couple ways to think about it. We think about ourselves as a platform, a two-sided platform. This is a hot topic in research right now. Uber, Airbnb, any number, Etsy, all of these companies are two-sided digital platforms that match folks with things to sell and people who want to buy those things, right? We're a little bit different than that, in that the shippers who come to us don't want to pick the truck. They want us to pick the truck for them. We work with at least 76,000 trucking companies, carriers, owner operators, and nobody wants to choose among that variety for themselves. They want to contract with us to do the work of picking the truck. And so what we provide is that matching service and then pricing. But what's kind of funny about our service as opposed to Uber or Airbnb, if you book an Uber or a Lyft, you pick the car, right? You know the license plate number, have a picture of the, you know, a cleaner version of the car, whatever. You pick the apartment or what you want to stay at. And those companies on those types of transaction either charge a percentage of the transaction or they charge a fee. So, like, if you want to participate in the platform, you pay $29 a month or something like that. So if you, for instance, want to buy books on Amazon Kindle, you're paying a monthly fee to be a Kindle member. You get your Kindle Unlimited. You get to pick the books you want. The author gets a cut of it. Don't return books on Kindle. It's really bad for the authors, just so you know. We are a little different because our shippers are not picking the truck in general, although our truckers are picking the load. And what
is it because the respective of the shippers, it's just kind of a uniform product service. So I don't really care which truck.
They care about service, but they do not care about the particular truck. There's nothing distinguishing about one dry van trailer from another dry van trailer, as long as they're both what is advertised. Yeah.
Kind of selling a commodity.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. A commodity with many distinguishing characteristics, but a commodity nonetheless. And then the other weird thing is that we tend to sell to the shipper with a long time horizon in my group, but we procure with a short time horizon. So that's the other reason I bring up the idea of a market maker. We have different time frames on both sides of that platform. So if anybody here is interested in like two-sided platforms and the structure of two-sided marketplaces, I think this is a really interesting area for research, because nothing in the literature that I've seen addresses this hybrid of a two-sided platform with this characteristic of making money off the bid-ask spread rather than a fee or a commission structure. So that's just a little bit of background on how we make money.
You're charging the shippers.
So we charge the shippers and we pay the carriers. Yes. Except Uber always makes money on every ride. So there are some circumstances in which they don't, but they do get a percentage of the transaction, right?
Or they moved away from percentages.
They did change their payment structure.
Yeah, now it's independent. Pay wage and pay price and then take the difference or eat the loss.
Yeah, so we're closer to their newer structure, their previous structure in which they got a percentage that varied, but nevertheless, they had some sort of percentage structure. Is not what we do. But yeah, so the structure in which we pay the carrier and we may or may not make money on it is what we've got right now. We need to make money in aggregate. So in that sense, it's more of an insurance or a financial problem, you know, you gotta make money on average.
And the reason, sorry,
yeah.
The reason is because you have to commit the shipper before you secure the carrier?
Yes. So we commit to the shipper in general before we have actually procured the carrier. And there are many details there. We do have preferred carrier programs. We have programs to set up repeating deals with carriers as well. But in general, we commit to one side and then we figure out how to do the other side, which is an adventure. So as I mentioned before, C.H. Robinson does many different types of logistics. It's a third-party logistics company throughout. You want to find an ocean carrier to bring your stuff here from Vietnam, we can do that for you. We can't do that for you if you're an individual person, interestingly. It's too much work to work with individuals. I had a family friend who was employed at one of the larger financial services companies in China, and she was moving to the US and she wanted to get a container to bring her stuff back. And we're like, we cannot help you as an individual. We only work with businesses, sorry. But we have global forwarding, ocean, air, et cetera. Truckload is our main business line. And that's what I work in. And so within that truckload space, we have three main groups in our data science group. So just for folks who are students, we have a structure where we have our commercial teams. They're working with shippers to figure out their needs. Our capacity teams working with carriers to figure out what they want and connect those two. And then data science sort of sits in between all of these. And data science serves various constituencies within the company. like one data science group working with many different parts of the business. So we have small groups in global forwarding and less than truckload, but our big three are contractual, transactional, and visibility. So transactional, here's my little spiel. Transactional is, I need a truck next Wednesday. How much is it gonna cost? Well, we'll give you a price. Contractual is, I need a truck every Wednesday for the next year. How much is that gonna cost? Give me one rate that will hold good for the next year. Okay, we'll do that for you. And then visibility is the question of, where's my truck? I know it picked up. Where is it on the road? Can I get some tracking information? That sort of thing. And visibility also, since it's relevant here, has huge roles when it comes to hurricanes and other natural disasters and events like that. They tend to help with appointment scheduling and with locations of warehouses. And so those things are very important when you're looking at hurricane impacts. Where are we going to need to ship plywood and bottled water and things like that before the hurricane? Where do we need to get our trucks out so that they're not impacted by a hurricane? And then afterwards, where do you, again, bring capacity in to help folks restock, repair, et cetera? So, yes, we do. We do intermodal. So we work with rail lines as well. It is a relatively smaller part of our business, but we're certainly happy to work with shippers who need that. I think the motto of CHR is basically like, you want it, we'll work with you on it as long as your business. But rail has been harder in the last few years, just for various organizational reasons. It's very popular for some sectors of the business, but it's been harder to do business with the rail companies in some ways. So I'm going to concentrate on contractual because that's the group that I have at C.H. Robinson. So we have between 9 and 13 data scientists, depending on the time of year and what kind of projects we're working on. We work closely with a team of engineers, and we work closely with some analysts. Data scientists and analysts are not interchangeable. Don't make that mistake because you're looking for jobs. You know what you're looking for. And then we also work with product managers, so product people who help set the direction of products and prioritize the data science work that we do. Analysts and data scientists. So yeah, it's different from organization to organization. And so what I urge folks looking for jobs to do is like set up an alert on Glassdoor or Indeed or, you know, these things and read the descriptions. What skills are companies asking for? But when we are hiring analysts, we want people with very good SQL skills, willing to really get into the data and understand both the data generating processes and the warehousing that we have for our data. So we work with Snowflake and we have various other ways of saving our data. And we want analysts who understand what that data is, how to get at it, how to put it together and do dashboarding and reporting. That's very important. But like when I need to get some drop trailer data and I say like, here are the characteristics I'm looking for, I don't know where this is stored. I go for an analyst, and analysts are knowledgeable about our business lines in a way that data scientists may or may not be. Then data scientists tend to do some more modeling and more more statistical analysis often of the data. So an analyst will be able to do some regression for you, but if you want to start doing design of experiments or something like that, that's usually a data scientist. We have some analysts who are really, really good, who I would trust with a lot of data science work, but you know, in general, analysts will take a first pass statistical analysis, and a data scientist will will take it farther. So depends what you want to do. So in our group, one of the things that we spend a lot of time is on is this large bid request for pricing. So I think this is, I'm trying to cover a number of things without getting too deep into the math to help you understand the context in which these problems show up. So I've been hearing all day about the types of classes folks take and the research people do. And we have many different flavors of mathematics, modeling, analytics, depending on what group you're in and what you're concentrating on. In these large bid requests for pricing, a large customer will come to us and say, "Hi, here is an Excel spreadsheet with 20,000 lanes, origins and destinations, and the mode by which we'd like you to ship these things. Please price all of these 20,000 lanes and send it back to us as an Excel spreadsheet. We'll process it and then we'll give you some feedback. And then you will send us a new revised set of pricing and we'll make a deal." So this is a process that is pretty painful because it involves Excel spreadsheets at this time, and that's changing. There are startups in the space and there's our own work trying to expedite this process. But basically big shippers say, "Hey, I have 25 distribution centers and I have all of these warehouses or stores. Give me pricing on every single lane that I will want to ship on." And then we say, "Okay, we'll do that." So this is an interesting process because often these are for the next year. So right now, for instance, we're getting these requests for pricing that would go live on January 1st and end at the end of 2023. So we have to do cost forecasting through the end of 2023 on a geographic lane like Omaha to Portland, Maine, refrigerated trucking for the next 15 months. And that's an interesting endeavor, right? There's a lot that changes in the world in 15 months, but we work with folks who analyze the economy and the fundamentals of business, our imports and exports as a nation, et cetera, to use time series models and blend them with expert opinion to come up with this type of forecast for costs.
So when producing a quote, you made it sound like you're producing quotes for each individual shipment, essentially.
Not shipment, but lane.
Okay, so what does lane
mean? Yes, yes, that's a very good question. So for me, a lane is an origin, a destination, and an equipment mode. So there are three main modes, equipment types. That we work with in truckload with their own characteristics. So when you see a tractor trailer on the road, a semi trailer, a semi truck, you know, you say, "Oh, I saw this semi, it nearly hit me." You're talking about this. On the other hand, the one that is like sitting near the grocery store and is noisy because it's got a refrigeration unit in it, that's a refrigerated van. So this we often call dry van. So you can put dry goods in here. Sure. Like if you have a food quality certification, you can put your pasta in a van, right? No problem. If you need to ship fish, you will want a refrigerated vehicle, not an unrefrigerated vehicle. Interestingly, you will also want a refrigerated vehicle if you are shipping, if you're shipping chips, like chips in a bag, because if you go through very hot climates, the chips will all explode if they're in the van too long. So there's some, like, you don't always have to have it refrigerated, but it's temperature controlled. And in the business, we call these reefers. don't think we're talking about something else. And then last of all, there's flatbed, and there's a number of flatbed equipment types, you know, step down trailers, and just, and you can put tankers on them, you can put lumber on them, you can put equipment, strap it down. This one is the worst to price because so often you have very unique characteristics. You know, you have to have this many straps or this many chains, tarps, equipment that holds tanks, rolls of wire, all kinds of stuff. So that's its own fun. We'll call them, what we have accessorial fees for the accessories that go with that. So getting back to your original question, lane is origin destination mode for me. And what we do is say, for your company that's shipping recycled paper or something like that, we'll take stuff from your facility in Omaha to the one in Portland using a dry van, and we will charge you $1.25 a mile for the next 6 months, and you will send us a certain volume. So they'll say, I think we're going to have 50 loads over the next 6 months. It's not that much, but you know, it adds up over time. Say, okay, given the 50 loads, we'll work this out.
So you do have some sort of volume based. It's not just totally a la carte, they can choose.
It should not be. Yeah, right. We do have some volume expectation. Everything, when I say a contract, it's a handshake. It's not, this is not marriage, this is dating, you know. Either party can leave at either time, at any time. There may be hurt feelings. We may hold it against each other, but there's nothing legally binding about a contract. And so the shipper may just stop providing any volume. And then we can say, you haven't lived up to the volume commitments that, like, we gave you this price because you said you'd have this volume. And then we'll have a conversation. Or they can send us too much, and we'll say, like, hey, we budgeted for essentially 20 trucks in this lane. You sent us 25. We need to procure additional capacity coming from further away. It costs more. So we will add a surcharge for volume above 20 a week, something like that. So you can have some complex structures. But what's interesting to me is, if you've thought about pricing, there's business to business pricing. There are these deals between big entities where you're like, hey, let's make a deal. And then there's business to consumer. You don't go to Target and say, I'd like to pay $1.25 for this instead of $3. Will you make me a deal? Because they're like, no, we'd just rather not sell to you, okay? But if like you're a chair manufacturer and you're working with the University of Minnesota to sell them all these nice chairs, you can work something out, volume discount, et cetera. And so this large bid space is like business to business pricing to a greater extent. And the small bid space is more like, here's our price. You only want to use us for five trucks or five lanes.
Is there a time dependency, like the contract, say, okay, for the month of January, this is our pricing, or the month of February?
We in general do not do structured contracts like that. What we do though is this index pricing. So if you are interested in floating with the market, we will use an external benchmark. Our partner here is DAT. And so we will peg to DAT and absorb some of the risk, but float you with that market. So, you know, we'll float you with the market with a cap on how much prices will rise in a month. So that's an interesting structure. That's not one of our larger offerings right now, but hey, if anybody's listening, we have a goal to expand that part of our business. So, you know, give me a call. So, yeah.
Because I could imagine that, like, in December, maybe trucking is in short supply and yes, prices are high. And so, if you made a 6-month commitment that said, yep, we'll give you this price, and everyone just chose to ship in December, that wouldn't be so great for you.
That's right. That's one of the interesting parts of this business. So it's a little bit like an insurance policy. And if you structure things so that people only exercise when it's advantageous to them, you have a real problem. So if I'm sitting here and I want to make a contract with a customer that goes through December, and I know that the cost will be like this, of course, there's an expected value calculation. You're like, oh, I think my average cost is here. So I'll price here so that I make some money. But it is certainly advantageous to the shipper to just not send you anything and put all their volume right here. And that's why we have account managers who are like, hey, we're giving you this price predicated on a volume of 20 loads per month. We need to see your volume here. If you're not delivering anything for the whole month of October, let's talk about it. We'll need to reprice. So there is a conversation like that that happens. And the question of when to reprice is very interesting and present. And
did you make amendments on the buy side as well?
So for with carriers?
With carriers.
Yes.
I mean, you make a similar commitment.
Yes.
You're gonna buy, yep, whatever, 6 months worth of.
You have to provide them enough business to make it worth their while. And again, yeah.
You have this large market, right? So
in some geographies, yes.
C.H. Robinson's at some level, it's probably like a determinant. Everything is.
So here's the thing, though. But this is the thing. If you're the carrier, you have a contract with C.H. Robinson, you're pretty happy here. But here, you just dump us and jump to the transactional market, right? Why not? What's the penalty for a carrier? And you might say, well, there's reputational risk. Like, we won't work with such carriers in the future. But one of the interesting phenomena in this space is that carriers, very small carriers in particular, often dissolve their business entity and reform under another name for many reasons, not least to deal with insurance increases and things like that. So it can be hard actually to track the continuity of a small business in this space. So the reputational risk is like an empty threat. They'll just dissolve, go work in another industry for a while, come back, and we won't know it's the same person. We do absolutely.
Yeah, small players.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, it's a very long tail. And we do absolutely have a number of programs in which we try to contract for capacity. And there are some very compelling reasons to do that on the carrier side as well. If a carrier wants to have a set route, a schedule, if they want to be home for their kids' softball games every weekend in softball season, then they need a certain level of predictability that we can provide. But if there are several types of carriers, there's folks who do this sort of really plan out what they're doing, and they want a schedule, they want to make it sustainable. And then there are folks who are like, I'm going to chase the dollars for 6 months and I'll exit the business for a while, you know. And you kind of have to know who you're dealing with. There's some interesting questions of capacity segmentation and how they engage with us, which is fun stuff. Yeah, so there's a lot to think about in this pricing process. I'm going to talk about the long-term forecasting part for a while. So obviously there's this cost forecasting, and then there's where you set the price. Those are different questions, right? We are in a market with many players. To some extent, we can assume that the cost is set externally. Like we can move the cost through good deals with carriers, through providing them what they want. But as a simplifying assumption on a national level, let's assume that the cost is set externally by the market. And we need to determine what's a competitive price and whether we should take that business. So separate questions. So I'm just taking a little bit of a a riff from the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics review. I got the SIAM review in my mailbox last year, 2021. And they had this article on the why, how, and where, when of representation of complex systems that I thought was a really thought-provoking read. So what's a complex system? A collection of objects or agents with high cardinality. Check. We have lots of shippers. We have lots of carriers. These objects or agents interact with each other in a non-trivial way. Check. There's all kinds of competition. And with our shippers and our carriers, there's this geospatial layering of demand and supply. And then the actions of these agents affect each other. And then the collective behavior is different from, or not immediately predictable from, the aggregation of individual behaviors. And that was, like, you read about this stuff, like, oh, complex systems, those seem really cool. But to see it in action, like, for real, in the companies that deliver your paper cups and your chairs and oil drilling equipment, is pretty interesting. So we have, that's one of the fun things about the contractual space in particular. I get to hang out with my transactional friends who are looking ahead like a week max, maybe 2 weeks, and try to learn from them. But we have this long-term behavior in which these collective behaviors emerge, which is kind of cool. So this number might be wrong by now. I don't remember how many carriers we interact with, but at one year, this was the published statistic. All of these companies are making their own decisions. There are large asset-based carriers, you know, 100 trucks, 200 trucks, 300 trucks. Many of them are our competitors. Some of them are our competitors, and we also contract with them. So that's fun. For instance, I'll leave it at that. Yeah, there are situations in which we've literally been bidding on something and we're like, we know that the only provider in this space is a carrier who we know is also in the auction process bidding against us. And we'd have, like, if we won it, we'd still give it to them. So why bother? If we are thinking of our agents as the carriers as agents, one of the phenomena we see is that trucking has a relatively low barrier to entry. It's not a trivial barrier to entry. You need to get a commercial driver's license. You need to get your a truck somehow. Like, it's, there is some expense, but you don't need a graduate degree, for instance. Like, you can accomplish getting a commercial driver's license and getting hired by a trucking company in a much shorter period of time than you can accomplish getting a master's or a PhD, right? And we have these big companies with lots of trucks, and then we have a lot of people who just, like, hey, I'm going to go into business for myself. And they're all making decisions in this context. They make decisions for their own individual benefit, whether it is chasing the dollars at periods of high cost, or whether it is prioritizing a good schedule, a sustainable schedule. But there's a huge aggregate behavior. So during COVID, for instance, trucking was very important, but commercial driver's license schools in general stopped functioning. People couldn't get CDLs. So the market was very constrained. There were a few entrants into the market, and construction was booming at the same time. Many truck drivers switched to construction based on whichever pays better, right? And construction was booming because everybody was remodeling if they had the money to do so. And they suddenly had the money to do so because they weren't going to Disney or whatever, right? So you can stay home and do construction. Construction's not easy either, but you don't have to be on the road for 3 weeks. You can just do construction. So there was a constraint on the inflow of truckers into the driver pool, and there was an outflow into other jobs that kept you closer to home and perhaps exposed you to less danger. Who wants to have COVID 3,000 miles from home and have to stay in a motel for 2 weeks? And this certainly did happen to some folks.
scale that will favor consolidation in the industry?
They are not strong enough. The number of independent owner operators skyrocketed during COVID, for instance.
So there's no huge advantage for carriers with 10,000 trucks versus 1,000.
I think the complexity of managing such a fleet becomes quite high, which is fine, but you don't make enough money maybe to justify that in general. We do have big competitors, asset-based competitors, J.B. Hunt, XPO, but they're the biggest. And there's not a lot of benefit to drivers to join some of these companies. Some companies treat their drivers very well. Others, as a driver, you feel very potentially exploited, right? And so there is a high incentive for drivers to start their own companies, to make a larger percentage of the profit. Like even during COVID, you saw like $15,000 bonus for truckers. If you read the fine print, it was $5,000 over 3 years as long as you met certain benchmarks. Like even the money that was flowing into trucking was not that great for truckers. And so there's a much higher incentive to start your own and keep the profit than work for several of the big carriers. And some carriers do treat their drivers very well, some don't. So one of the things that I want to bring up for folks is it's not always being able to solve the problem that's the most important thing. It's being able to ask the right question. So you can say that we deal with many carriers, each making their own economic decisions. That's true. That's correct. That's very useful. But we also deal with many lanes, each of which has a certain capacity. And when the price in the lane goes up, it draws capacity from other neighboring lanes. And so there's this sort of geographic point of view as well, where capacity flows across the network. This is also true and useful. Different problem related. So So when I say willingness of drivers to deadhead, for instance, like, are you going to drive 250 miles with an empty truck to pick something up? If there the supply and demand imbalance is such that there's not a lot to pick up, then you're like, fine, I'll drive 250 miles empty, making no money to pick this load up and make some money. But if capacity is really tight and there's a lot of demand, then you're like, no, I don't need to drive there. And so rural areas are particularly impacted in high demand, constrained capacity situations, because truckers are like, why do I have to drive? I don't need to drive there. I can pick up a very profitable load only 40 miles from my house. So this is the Cass Truckload Line Haul Index. It's a line, it goes up because it's money. And so inflation just gets you going up. It's not super interesting all by itself, but it is publicly available. Cass Information System aggregates a lot of trucking data, and their other indices are available through FRED, the Federal Reserve's time series library, which anybody doing time series research should know about. FRED's library from the Federal Reserve of St. Louis, super cool, free, taxpayer money. If you look at the year over year for that system, you get a much more interesting picture. And this year over year cyclicality is what we tend to use to look at the freight cycle. There's this huge freight cycle. And this isn't even the clearest picture, but it is freely available non-proprietary information. So it makes it convenient for these purposes. There's a couple articles here about the shipping cycle, the truckload market cycle, including from our competitors, because they write better blog posts than we do, sorry. This cycle is what I find interesting, because it kind of points at this oversupply of truckers. Like, a lot of people enter the market when prices are high, they try to make a living at it, and then like prices start coming down. They're like, shoot, I can't make money at this anymore. I'm going to exit into construction. And then the supply of truckers goes down very low and capacity is constrained. And then shippers will be like, oh my goodness, the holidays are coming. I'll pay anything to get this freight out. Prices go up and we repeat this cycle all over again. It's an interesting cycle. There's a bullwhip effect. You can do all kinds of econometrics here. But what's interesting to me is that it's different than the business cycle. So we also have a business cycle in the US, and this is from the National Bureau of Economic Research. It's not showing up the recessions very well. It says shading denotes recessions. The recessions disappeared in my PowerPoint. But I think you can imagine where the recessions are. There were unemployment spikes, right, for a long enough period of time. The freight market and the business cycle do not match up for various reasons. But it's an interesting big class of problems where traditional time series methods actually aren't that useful, because you really need to take into account the cyclicality that happens. And so I'll give you a tour of a few time series techniques just for fun. This is the one I'll use as an example. This is a lane, so origin somewhere in the southwest that grows lettuce. Destination somewhere not in the southwest that doesn't grow lettuce. Mode refrigerated. And it's a smallish lane. There's not that much data. What I have is the cost and the price. This is real data, so I'm not going to tell you where it is. And the purple dots are what we actually paid. You can see that this is not a single valued series. Like there's a range. Like when you got to get lettuce out, you got to get lettuce out. You cannot let it sit 3 days in the desert. It's not going to work out. So in a really tight market, you'll pay what you need to pay. So one of the things that I think is interesting is, like, sure, you see the seasonality. Lettuce is only grown, harvested part of the year. You don't grow it year round outside. And so you have this steep seasonality, but then you also have some larger waves. Maybe you don't see it that strongly here because this is at the lane level and it's only in the aggregate that that cycle, the freight cycle, emerges. But one of the things I think you can see at the lane level, let's see if this works. There, you can see maybe what happens to the height of the peaks, not to the main median line, but how high it goes. So the magnitude of the range of costs really does seem to have some amplitude to it. And our last freight recession is right in here. You didn't have to pay very much. Like there's a lot of low ones. And then the last freight peak was back here at the height of the lettuce season. You had to pay a lot of money. And boy, in 2021, you had to pay a lot of money to get your lettuce shipped. So that's in contrast to a lane driven more by import volumes. This is an import volumes lane. You can see that imports went nuts during COVID. I won't spend a lot of time on this one because I got too excited about lettuce. So I'll just show you a couple time series methods. I listed a few of my favorites, but for the purposes of this talk, due to length, I concentrated on two. TBATS and BSTS are great. We can talk about it. But here's my lane again. I just want to talk about the idea of being able to decompose your time series into pieces, which is really useful in a business context. So you can do it additively or multiplicatively. We use multiplicative because the way that money works, in essence, with inflation, multiplicative is the way to go. Like, you can't get too much cheaper on shipping goods by truck, but you can get very expensive. So there's a sort of log normality to it. that works well with multiplicative time series. So here's a picture of what you can do. This is using STL through stats model in Python. So STL has some great libraries in R as well. If you use R, don't worry, it's still the best for time series. But I tried to do it in Python. So one of the cool things is that you have the seasonality term, and you can pick parameters telling you how much that seasonality changes over time. And then you can look at the trend. Well, we can see that 2021 was a little different in the trend, no surprise. And then, of course, the goal is to get a residual that's distributed around zero. And you can see that there's some interestingness over there. So that's an ugly version of the time series. And that's our forecast for the next year. Okay, that's cool. Let's compare it to Prophet. Prophet is a very popular time series library put out by Facebook. It's available in R and Python. It's really easy to get started with. So if you want to do analysis of time series, super easy, like 8 lines of code, off you go. One of the reasons people like it, especially for commercial applications, is that you can put in, it has the holidays encoded in. It has these business time features automatically included. And you can play with change points. It will do automatic change point detection for you, like, hey, your system changed. Maybe a large event like a pandemic happened. It'll do that for you automatically, or you can set them yourself. You can get into the code and set those change points yourself, which is, if you know that something happened, legislation passed or something like that, you can set those yourself and see what happens. But despite all its coolness, I don't really like Prophet. Sorry. I have many friends who are great devotees of Prophet, but what I find is that in its forecasting, it picks up too strongly on linear trends and doesn't capture the multi-cyclic nature of the market very well. It's my personal opinion. We can argue about it later. I have a lot of practice. So you can get into Prophet and set some of the cyclicality, like from my calculations, it's like a 41-month freight cycle. And you can set that yourself if you want, but you have to modify some not very well documented parts of the code to do that. And I just wanted to compare those two forecasts for this produce lane with my. I'm gonna ask this question. And then we can go back to other techniques if you want. But like, which forecast was better? They're both intellectually defensible. They both have pluses and minuses. Who cares? Which one should you use? So part of what I wanted to get to in this talk is that there are a lot of ways to use math and make models that are defensible. But what are the effects? How is it going to be used? So which is the better mistake? So we talked about pricing structures before and how these are all handshake contracts. Anyone can walk away. Maybe we have hurt feelings or there are business ramifications, but there's no legal ramification to not honoring a freight contract. If I go back to this picture, which one's the better forecast for my cost? I have to set a price based on this. And this STL has these big peaks. Maybe it's actually better at predicting the peaks in my seasonal produce lane, but it goes down pretty low too. which may be defensible, but if I price using the absolute like expected value here, I'm going to put out a very different price than if I price using that expected value. What's better? Which one?
Lower one.
The lower one? Why?
I believe like taking an analogy for inventory, if you're planning for inventory or something like that, you would like to plan for lower demand rather than stacking up and not selling it. And you want to sell up everything that you have, making less profits rather than taking higher losses.
Yeah, there are several ways to think about this, but as you said, you want to be able to actually sell. And part of the problem with the higher forecast, this is kind of working not. If we price much higher than our competition based on this high expectation, especially since psychologically everybody's anchoring on the lower actual price right now, we simply will not sell anything. And if you don't sell anything, then you're not in business. If you price here though, you face significant risk, right? So how do you hedge that risk? Especially since I'm looking at a peak here. So what if I price at this expected value for the next year and my shipper tenders me many, many loads right away and I lose a lot of money? That's not so good either. So these are the types of trade-offs that we have to think through. And so as we were doing some design of experiments, even recently, we're thinking through what's the asymmetric risk associated with doing this experiment where we lower prices in certain areas and see what the competitive cost is. It can be tough to decide. And that's why, I don't know, I may have taken this slide out, but I talked about some pretty classical time series models. Of course we can do simulation, and of course we can do machine learning. Of course we can do deep learning. Everybody wants to know, why aren't you using neural networks to price your stuff? Well, in part because if I use a neural network and I have to explain to the vice president on the food and beverage vertical, well, trust me, this risk is worth taking. It's pretty hard to explain with a neural network. With a seasonal trend decomposition type model, you can say like, look, the seasonality is this. This is a regular year for lettuce production. We expect this. And you can break it apart and talk about the holiday effect, the produce, et cetera. So I think we're getting towards the end of our time, is that correct? So maybe at this point we can stop recording and I'll say a few words about a project with Ankur but then go for questions. So with Ankur, we're starting a project on drop trailer location. So what we talked